Hey guys, what's up? So yeah, this is my third attempt trying to get this one done. I am really hope I'm able to get this video out by the end of the year, and the deadline is like right there, so we'll see. But I promise I will try to have something out, and it's gonna be on swords. Actually, it's just gonna be just on swords, not martial arts, but swords. It's something that I find rather interesting, particularly about the Chinese sword market and Chinese swords these days, how we view them, what we expect from them, how we expect them to look, so on and so forth. So let's hurry the hell up. And yeah, I know I look like hell. I really need to do something better with the lighting in here. I'm hoping to get that fixed within the next couple of weeks, but we'll see. But yeah, let's get on with it, right? Chinese swords. These days, recording this now at the very end of the year 2021. It seems that we're getting more and more spoiled for choice. That's if you're into Chinese weapons, Chinese swords, things like that. We got more than one company now offering them. We can access them easier now. There's, even general sword marketplaces like Cult of Athena, which specializes, in selling swords from a variety of different sources and different cultures. The Chinese ones are now prominently displayed, and there's so many different ones we can choose from different companies. It's great, right? And it also had a lot of different price ranges, which was also pretty good. But I remember a time when that just was not the case. If you grew up in the 80s and 90s, and if you were practicing martial arts around that time and wanted to get into Chinese weaponry, there really wasn't much to choose from. And not only that, but as far as how they looked, what you would expect from their design, blade lengths, fittings, things like that, there also really wasn't much to choose from. Chances were the stuff that you were working with was good for training and drills and forms and not much else. I mean, these were not going to be blades in case you were somehow thrown into a zombie apocalypse or something. These would not save you, despite statements to the contrary. I still even remember certain martial arts manuals going, "Oh, any spring steel sword made these days would be the equivalent to or superior to anything made in antiquity." And that's not true at all. We didn't even realize, I mean, hell, half of us didn't even know what spring steel was. We just, went to a kung fu store and saw the swords on the wall. We're like, "I went one with spring steel." We didn't realize what high carbon steel was, and we didn't realize we were getting something that was a mild carbon steel at best. And yeah, it's sort of spring steel, but which means it snaps, but these are thrusting swords. Things aren't supposed to Yeah, we didn't know much. Chances were the sword that you were working with was going to look something like this, right? That those of you who are in the know, what you're nodding your head right now. You know this design, and you also know the name Lung Chuen. The Lung Chuen Forge. We all heard about it back then. Like, this was supposed to be this legendary forge where all these swords came from, the top end ones came from. Like, if you were practicing Chinese martial arts and you wanted to get yourself a good sword, if you wanted to get yourself a good one, you had to make sure it came from the Lung Chuen Forge, because that's the one that's been making great swords for centuries. That long tradition that goes all the way back to that legend of that, one famous married couple where the husband ends up having to sacrifice the wife to make a good sword for the king. You've heard that one. Yeah, that Lung Chuen. And it's funny how much we didn't really know about what Lung Chuen was. Lung Chuen isn't the forge. There is no Lung Chuen Forge. Or, well, there kind of is, but there kind of isn't. See, what we didn't know back then was Lung Chuen is a city. It's a place with a whole lot of forges. They all make swords. It's a tradition in that city. Like people from there, their business, it tends to be all the different families there, they make swords. That's the town's main livelihood. It's like think of Las Vegas. The main thing that town is known for is gambling. Doesn't mean that every single last person living there are all working at the casinos. I mean, I'm sure there's some car dealerships, right? I'm sure there's, furniture stores. I'm sure there's some other industries there, but by and large, they're known for gambling.
Prostitution.
Gambling, okay? And that's what they're, that's, you know, what a lot of people are going to end up doing over there. Well, Long Chuen is known for swords. Now, the one thing is true. Quality swords did and still do come from there. What they weren't really telling us in the West, though, is that the stuff that we were getting from there, one, wasn't just coming from one forge. Again, there's a whole bunch of them. Different families and state-owned facilities happen to be there. The one you're getting might, somebody, you will have two swords that look exactly the same, but one may come from one facility and the other one may come from another facility. And we weren't getting the high-end stuff, because the really good high-end stuff was gonna cost thousands of dollars. We never got to see those. We just got to see the stuff that when they came over here in the States, $60, $70, you know, around that range. And again, decent for training, not much else. We didn't know any better. Now, why am I mentioning all this? Well, let's first look at this design right here. This particular design, you happen to notice, was pretty ubiquitous. In fact, you can still get this today. If you're practicing Chinese martial arts, even if you weren't around during the 80s and 90s, early 2000s, let's say you just got into this around the 2000s or so, you most likely still know this design. It's probably sitting somewhere in the wall in your school. You can still get it. What I find interesting is if you look at old drawings, old pictures, you don't see that. Like, it's funny how the Zen these days, at least up until recently, have mostly been based on Ming and Qing era sword designs. Yet that particular design, you don't really see, you know, in antiques or drawings and such like that. Where the hell did that come from? The best I've been able to trace for this, and I am willing to admit, I'm probably wrong. I used to have this information and I lost it somehow. If I'm wrong and somebody knows for sure, feel free to correct me on this. But there happens to be this well-known workshop, like it's like the place, you know, in Long Chuen City, called Shen Guan Long, and I'm pretty sure I am butchering that. I'm sorry. Shen Guan Long, it's owned by this well-known, like, master sword maker there called, look at the name, I got it on the side here, Xin Pei Shen. Xin Pei Shen? Again, I'm probably butchering the hell out of that. Well-known smith. Like, he's like a master smith. He had actually made swords for like world leaders before, like at his government's behest. He's well known for making Tai Chi swords. I am quite certain he was the one who first started that design, and then other people started copying it. Other facilities, other forges. Notice I keep saying facilities. What I really should be saying are factories. Because these days in China, like, the word forge puts in your mind a small or medium-sized place. A master there, a few apprentices, they're working with their hand tools, maybe they got, you know, a, you know, automatic hammer, you know, using power tools. Now, these days they're factories, straight up factories. Like, if you go to AliExpress, for instance, and you start looking up sword stuff, you ever notice that they're like sword fittings, you know, hand guards, pommels, that you can buy hundreds of them wholesale because they're churning these things out in an assembly line. Like, this is big business, especially in China. So it's no longer just a forge. You got straight up factories churning this stuff out. Doesn't necessarily mean that they're crap. And here I need to stress that I'm not trying to, you know, knock on, you know, Long Chuen or try to say that, oh, these guys, I'm not trying to bring them down a peg. It's, if, let's say I'm, you know, one day I happen to be fortunate enough to travel to the country. One of the places I want to visit is Long Chuen. I want to, like, go to the different, if I'm allowed to go to the factories or at least a couple of stores and hopefully have some saved up money, like, when am I going to get? Because I know there's really great swords over there, but I'm just also kind of peeling back the myth a little bit. Like, there isn't this, you're not going to be going to a mountain somewhere with some old guy and a bunch of young students. I mean, yeah, there's going to be masters and students, but this is a modern town making stuff with modern means. And only if you want to get like the handmade stuff from a master, like an ultimate master who's doing it all by hand and doing this mastercraft stuff, kind of similar to getting a decent katana in Japan, be prepared to spend thousands of dollars, okay? But we didn't know this at the time in the 80s and 90s. We just knew this stuff. What does it have to do with what I'm trying to talk about now? Well, these days, the gen that you happen to see everywhere besides this is this. Yeah, that design and different variants of it. That's fairly recent. A little bit older than some of you guys might think, but that design came from somebody else. Enter Zhu Zhengwu, and once again, I am probably butchering his name, and I apologize if I do, but he's another master smith. And he was born in Longchun, and he came upon the scene, you know, like started getting famous, his name started spreading in the early 2000s. And I believe he'd already picked up a couple of awards and notoriety things. But in, I think, 2005, around 2004, 2005, he, after, you know, mastering patterns, like patterned steel blades, it's funny, these days you can get them all over the place in China at different varying qualities. But before, you weren't getting these things from China. At least they weren't known for it. He really started popularizing it, kind of like mastering the technique and really going off with it. And then with that, he then looked at some older sword pieces from museums and came up with this sucker here, which I already showed the picture of, but I might as well show the one that I have, this model. What he called his Hanwu Jian, which we these days just simply call a Han Jian. Based, you know, sword from the Han Dynasty. Han Dynasty Jian. This is supposed to be based on Han Dynasty designs. The scabbard shape, the, you know, hand guard, the sword hanger here, the pommel. All this is supposed to be Han Jian stuff, and it was supposed to be based on a museum piece. And it took off. Why? Well, not only is it a beautiful looking piece, beautiful sword. It's still one of my favorite sword designs ever. But you didn't see it in the market anywhere. Everything looked like that, and some variant of it. A few, like, different ones here and there, but for the most part, they looked like that. And then this pops up. Yeah, this is going to turn heads. Some of you guys might be surprised to find out this popped up around 2005, but yeah, it's 2005 that this showed up. I remember when I first saw it, I had to own it. Like, I saw it around 2005, like, when I stumbled on this now-defunct website. And I saw a couple of other designs, like, I've seen this already, and that one looks kind of ugly, I don't really want it. And then I saw this, and I'm like, oh! And years later, thanks to a smaller company called Jinshi, that were offering swords at decent prices, rather than the thousands, I finally was able to get my hands on it, because Zhengwu, when Zhou Zhengwu was selling it, he was going for at least $1,100, if I remember correctly. A lot of money, I wasn't making that kind of money at that time. No way. So, yeah, by, I'd say, around 2007, 2008, 2009-ish, now people were slowly able to get their own version of this. Granted, not with patterned steel yet. Mine's mono steel, still good steel. In fact, that sword is still holding on strong. But, yeah, we were finally able to get our own affordable versions of it, albeit at $300 still is a bit much for some people, but it's a lot better than $1,100, right? Nowadays, that design's a dime a dozen. You can find it everywhere. Everybody's got it. It's become so ubiquitous that there's some people out there who don't even realize that this thing is called typically a Hanjin. They know it as an Avatar sword. From, you know, Avatar The Last Airbender. What's his name? Toka? Like, when he made his own sword. It's based on this. Because the guy that consulted for the martial arts in the cartoon, Kisu, who happens to be a kung fu teacher, you know, a martial arts, Chinese martial arts instructor, he has one of these in his school hanging on the wall. The animators saw it and they're like, oh, that looks cool, you know, and they based his thing off that design. And there are sites now selling that as an Avatar sword, which I find hilarious. You can find this thing everywhere now at so many price ranges. You can get one above $1,000 with all the bells and whistles, or you can get one for around $150. And again, varying degrees of quality. Some are going to have decent steel, some stainless steel, some short, some long, all over the place. It's turning into this. It's this again. But now with this. By the way, and I know this is going on a bit long and I want to hurry up and get to my point. What I'm finding interesting about this, and this is how I ended up finding out about LK Chen, even though we call this a Han Tian, and many times, a Han Dynasty Tian, it's not really based on any one particular sword, unlike the swords that LK Chen puts out. The stuff that he tends to put out are usually based on a single piece, or at least, based on a general design that had been seen. This is more of a hodgepodge. These fittings here are all from different swords. And if you will quickly spot that if you mix and match those, you get this. The handguard here, and the sword hanger here, and the pommel there, and these are all different pieces from different swords. I like this one, so let's put this one together, make a whole, and that's what this is. The funny thing is the blade length. I think this is, 80 centimeters, 82 centimeters, something like that? A 32-inch blade, I know it for that much. If we were going to base this on a survival piece, at least based on the handguard, this should be much longer. The blade should be closer to, say, the freaking eagle one that I have back there, or the, roaring dragon. Like that, it would be closer, to the blade length. And I have yet to see these, with this design, with that blade length, and with, of course, the correct shape for the hilt. So, it's funny. Nowadays, when we think of Chinese swords, now we're thinking about this. Or, Ming and Qing dynasty designs with that kind of ace of spades shaped handguard, and, like the other handguard shaped like that. We don't really see this. I mean, we still see that, but in the higher end, that's not what we're looking at anymore. And nowadays, thanks to LK Chen, now we're looking at stuff like this and consider that's a Chinese sword. It's interesting to me how these days, what's shaping the image of a Chinese sword in our minds is based on market trends that are being followed. Because before, that design became popular because they were copying a Master Smith, and that became the market trend. Then this came out and became popular, and they started copying it, became a market trend because they were, again, copying off of a swordmaster, and his design got popular. Boom, now that became popular. And now I'm beginning to see variations of this. And of course, this is the older version of this sword. LK Chen now has a more updated model, but that updated model, I'm seeing in other companies now. I can think of at least two places where I've seen a variation of that sold by two other companies. Once again, market trends and what are making things popular is what is changing the idea of the typical Chinese sword, the typical shape of it, blade length, things like that. This is not to say that things like, say the design that Hanwei used with Scott Rodell's sword, which is based, again, on a late Qing dynasty model, Ming dynasty models. This is not to say that we will not see those. Of course we still see those, and we still like them. I still like them. But it's kind of interesting how these market trends are kind of shaping in our minds what a Chinese sword looks like, at least the straight blades, the Jin. And when you consider that handguards, at least if we're going to be basing our knowledge on what was told about them, how they were drawn in the past, there were a variety of different shapes. We just don't really know because we don't really have too many surviving models anymore. But I just kind of find it interesting how the Chinese market, which is known for copying what's popular, let's be honest, no matter what's being sold, whether it's swords, whether it's electronics, they tend to copy what's popular. We're seeing this with swords now. And it's kind of shaped in our mind what a sword should look like. So, I find that interesting. I hope you guys found that interesting. I've actually had to leave out a lot of information to try to keep this video at a decent length. maybe I'll talk about it more in the live stream that I'm doing. So, I hope you found this interesting. There's so much more I could talk about with the different sword masters, but I gotta hurry up, edit this, and try to get this out for the end of the year. I hope you guys like it. Take care. Happy New Year. Hopefully, this one's probably going to be a doozy, but hopefully you guys will survive and get through it. Hopefully it will yield you guys some better results. And catch you guys later.